Hey friends, welcome back to my channel. Welcome to part two of every single book that I read for my MFA program. So if you want to catch the first one, I'll link it up there. But that was covering all the literary fiction, poetry, short stories, nonfiction. And today we're going to be covering all things fantasy. So whether you're looking for a recommendation for a new favorite fantasy book to read, or you're just here to talk about books with me, either way, thank you so much for being here, and I really hope you enjoy. So my camera keeps overheating, so I made myself a new little matcha. I also reset the tier list because it was getting a little crowded in there, so we're going to do a version just for the fantasy books, but there are a lot of them, so. All right, here we go. Import all them photos. All right, where should we start? All right, Pure and Easy by Susanna Clarke. This is one of those books that is like impossible to describe. You just gotta go read it. It's really short. You can binge read it really quickly. Let me just read you the description because it defies explanation, at least for me. Piranesi's house is no ordinary building. Its rooms are infinite, its corridors endless, its walls are lined with thousands upon thousands of statues, each one different from all the others. Within the labyrinth of the halls, an ocean is imprisoned. Waves thunder up staircases, rooms are flooded in an instant. But Piranesi is not afraid. He understands the tides as he understands the pattern of the labyrinth itself. He lives to explore the house. There's one other person in the house, a man called the Other, who visits Piranesi twice a week and asks for help with research into a great and secret knowledge. But as Piranesi explores, evidence emerges of another person and a terrible truth begins to unravel, revealing a world beyond the one Piranesi has always known. Susanna Clarke is the like best-selling, brilliant, genius author of Jonathan Strange and Mr. Norrell, and this is like the complete opposite. It's so small. This was like a cult classic released during the pandemic. And when she was interviewed about the making of this book, Susanna Clarke basically described it as like an inverse horror book. And by that she means like horror stories are basically about a secret at the heart of the world that's inherently evil. But this is like a secret at the heart of the world that's inherently good. It's really just a brilliant book. I would put this pretty high up. Let's see, what should we do it? I think it's earned a hallowed place upon my shelves. The next one is a classic. It's The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe. I reread this, I think, for my first semester, just as kind of a dip into the fantasy genre again. It's just like classic. I mean, it's 5 stars. It's a wonderful book. Although there were things that I questioned when I was reading it this time around that like I took for granted as a kid, like why is Father Christmas just randomly appearing in the middle of the book? That I feel for Tolkien, where he read C.S. Lewis and was just like, what the heck? If for some reason you haven't actually read this book, it's about 4 children in World War II who are sent off to the countryside to avoid the London bombings. While they are there in this mansion of this professor, they discover this magical wardrobe that can transport them to another world. And this world is called Narnia, and there's talking animals and this whole prophecy that they are sent to fulfill. Classic, wonderful story. So I would put that in the masterpiece category. It's just beautiful. Next up, kind of changing gears a little bit, but this is Catherine Valente's book Deathless, and this is a really fun spin on Russian folklore, kind of like an alternate history novel. It's sort of like the Russian Revolution meets traditional Russian folklore, like they kind of merge together a little bit. Valente has this really incredible skill at narrative voice. I feel like she's always got such intriguing narrators, and this is the case in another book that I'll show you a little later that she wrote as well. But anyway, this is like a very dark and intriguing fairy story that's kind of got like this grim and slightly morbid sense of humor, but it's a really fun ride. I really enjoy her writing. Let's see, Deathless. I think I'd read it again. The next book, which is also by Catherine M. Valente, is called The Past is Red. So this is actually a very, very tiny little book. And this is actually comprised of 2 short stories, 2 novellas, I guess you would call them. One is called The Past is Red, and the second is The Future is Blue. So these are super, super short. You could read them in an afternoon if you wanted to. They will 100%, by the time you finish these, you will be outraged about environmentalism. So this is considered climate fiction, but it's kind of like a futuristic dystopia set in the not too distant future where the world has been flooded due to global warming, and the only surviving people live on this floating island of trash in the middle of the Pacific Ocean. And this is another one where I feel like explaining what it's about won't really do it justice to the actual experience of reading the book, but it's about this girl who is the most hated girl in Garbage Town, and you're following her as a child as she grows up to learn what happened, what she did, to have earned that hatred from everybody, but it's just like witty and devastating and full of these twists and turns. There were some mighty plot twists in this book. I don't normally dip into like the climate fiction type stories, but this was really good. It does have like a ton of language in it. I don't know if that bothers anybody else. It kind of bothered me, but I looked past it for the sake of the story, but I generally don't like to read books with this much profanity in them. Personal preference. So where would I put that? Let's see. The Past is Red. I would put that in. I'd reread that. They were good. So these next two books are Fable and Namesake by Adrienne Young. Pretty cool covers, right? So these are kind of like young adult fantasy. It's about the daughter of a powerful sea captain who is abandoned on this island of thieves, and she has to prove herself by getting off of it. The one thing I will say about these books is it's got a very interesting magic system relating to gems and gemstones. I just felt like the whole story, honestly, for me, fell really flat. Book two is a little bit better, but all the characters on the whole felt really two-dimensional to me. Like, it was a very ambient story, and I haven't seen a ton of fantasy set on the ocean, so that was cool. But I just personally didn't love any of the characters, and that's really like what gets me into a story is the characters. So let's see, I'm gonna put that in the first category. It's just not my thing. And kind of similarly, I also read What the River Knows by Isabel Ibanez. I always feel bad about pronouncing people's names, I'm never sure. So this is also young adult, it's historical fiction with kind of like a touch of fantasy. This one's basically about an Argentinian girl whose parents, who are archaeologists in Egypt, go missing, and so she ends up crossing the ocean to try to figure out what happened to them. And I think on the whole, like, I really enjoyed the Egyptian ambiance and the flavor of this book, but personally it just didn't really... I feel really bad saying anything negative about books, but it just was not my cup of tea. It felt very predictable. I just can't get behind this kind of romance novel. It just feels... the whole, like, enemies to lovers, if it's not done really well, it can feel kind of cheesy. And this just kind of didn't deliver what I wanted it to. So honestly, not for me. Okay, so the next book is The 100,000 Kingdoms by N.K. Jemisin. This one was like a really richly imagined world. I was really impressed by the world building in the story, but it's kind of like one part court drama, one part murder mystery, and one part coming of age. And it had a really interesting mythic side to it that I really enjoyed. The heroine was really clever, really courageous, which I appreciated. I really liked the main character in the story. And yeah, I just remember getting really pleasantly lost in that story. So I enjoyed that one quite a lot. I think I would probably... I don't know that I'd read that one again, but I'm really glad I read it once. So the next one is Nettle and Bone by T. Kingfisher. This one had kind of like a fun premise. It's about this princess who embarks on a quest to kill a prince, who is actually her sister's husband. She kind of accumulates this mismatched bound of outcasts that are like become her found family as she endeavors to fulfill these quests to get a poison to kill the prince, I think. So this is all my fuzzy memory. This was like a year and a half ago, but... So yeah, I enjoyed reading it quite a lot. I don't think I would read it again, though. All right, next one is A Song for a New Day by Sarah Pinkner. This is a really interesting book because this was published in 2019, and it's about a deadly pandemic that has taken over the world, and gatherings of large amounts of people has become outlawed. Despite that, despite the kind of growth of virtual reality, there are still a lot of underground people who gather to see live music because there's something about the effect of live music that can't quite be replicated in virtual reality. So it's told from two different characters' perspectives. One of them is kind of an underground musician, and then the other one is trying to ferret out and root out the bands who are performing illegally and try to get them to perform in a studio for virtual reality. So, and a lot of the world building is really interesting in this because it is basically exactly predicting what happened during the pandemic. So really interesting, but it's ultimately just this rallying cry for the importance of live music and connection. I thought the characters and the settings were really, really incredibly written. So yeah, this was a good one. I really enjoyed this. Yeah, I'm trying to think. I don't know if I would reread this one. I don't think I would. I know this is random, but I just had a craving for some reason between semesters to read Harry Potter and the Goblet of Fire. It's like the middle of the series. It's not even the beginning or the end, it's just the middle. Picked it up, I think, over Christmas break between semesters. Yeah, I don't know. I was just randomly in the mood. I still don't really understand why my advisor let me put this on the list, but she was okay with it. So 20 books a semester is a lot of books. So I had to take some shortcuts where I could. See what you're not seeing behind the camera here? Is that my camera has overheated like 15 times in the making of this. I have now been filming this for about 4 hours. That's fine. So next up on our foray into the fantasy realm is his dark materials. So golden compass, subtle knife, and the amber spyglass. All by Philip Pullman. I really wanted to love these books. I really enjoyed his writing style, first of all. I felt like the series went downhill after the first one. And the first one I was enjoying really a lot up until the last like 10% of the book. I don't know, just like theologically, I'd love to sit down with Philip Pullman and just be like, hey, what does this mean? So yeah, I think I'm gonna put those three, I would put those in the one and done category. I think I'm glad I read them, but I don't think I'd read them again. Okay, so next up we have The Raven Cycle by Maggie Stiefvater. I really love her writing style. I thought these books were really, really fun. Basically the setting is in a small town in Virginia, there's this group of teenage friends who are hunting to find the burial site of an old Welsh king that's buried somewhere on this ley line that's running through their town. So it's got lots of interesting world building. I loved the friendship dynamics between the four characters. It's just like full of the camaraderie and the witty banter of like ride or die friendships, which I really enjoy. Stiefvater, I feel like she's just a master of writing characters. Like her depictions of people and their like quirky characteristics and defining details just makes them all seem so lifelike. So I really enjoyed the series. I would definitely read this one again. Next up is The Book of the Dun Cow by Walter Wangerin Jr. How do you even describe this book? Okay. It's basically about this rooster named Chanticleer and his troop of hens and this group of barnyard animals that must kind of group together in order to defeat this evil worm. Not worm as in like a worm, but a worm as in like a dragon that lives at the heart of the earth and is slowly corrupting the whole world and will soon take over their barnyard. So it's really, I found it really rich with this delightful dramatic irony that's very quintessential in like C.S. Lewis's writings. So if you like Lewis, you might like this one as well. In the end, like the whole struggle for good and evil, I thought generally the whole story was profoundly wise and it had a lot of really interesting things to say. It did feel kind of like a kid's story, but maybe a kid's story that has profound meaning if you return to it as an adult. So I think it's one I'd reread. All right, next up, The Ballad of Songbirds and Snakes by Susan Collins. I'm assuming most people know what this one is, but this is the prequel to The Hunger Games that was released in 2020, and it follows the coming of age of Coriolanus Snow, who ends up being President Snow in the Hunger Games series. So it takes place during the 10th annual Hunger Games, and it really shows the formation of Coriolanus Snow's way of viewing the world. So what's interesting to me about this book is it's very much rooted in the nature of man debate. So are humans inherently good or evil? And how does society shape them to be one or the other? It's a really interesting, really interesting book. And The Book Leo did a really interesting video essay on this that I'll link down below or share above or something. But if you're interested to know like more of the what's actually under the surface of the whole narrative, go check that essay out because it's really, really interesting. I thought, yeah, the structure of the story was really interesting and it had a very, very unreliable narrator, but that was kind of fun. I enjoyed that. So I think that one I'd reread. Yeah, solidly in the middle. So next up we have Babel. Basically, this is a dark academia novel set in Oxford. It features a really interesting magic system that's all about language translation. So it's kind of like the gap between, if you think about a word in two different languages, kind of the gap of meaning between those two versions of the same word. That's the source of the magic. I don't know. It's like described much more beautifully in the actual book, but it's a really intriguing magic system. It does do a really great job of engaging the whole problem of British colonialism. But I think when I finished it, I felt like the whole last quarter of the book kind of fell flat because it just felt really one-sided and it felt like it turned into something, I don't know. I don't even know, but just, so I would personally rate that as a one and done. Yeah, I don't think I'd reread this one just because the ending like kind of ruined the whole story for me. Okay, so the next one is An Enchantment of Ravens. So I lent this one out to a friend, so I don't have the physical copy, but so it follows Isabel, who is a prodigy portrait artist, but her clients are the kind of sinister and elusive Fae. But when she paints human emotion into the Fae's eyes, she ends up making really powerful enemies in the Fae court. So she's kind of whisked away on this adventure and there's kind of this cute love story and she's in the Fae courts trying to survive and kind of outwit the fae that are hunting her. Ultimately, she has to choose between immortal life with her true love or her skill of painting. Because what's really interesting about this world is that for the fae, human craft, so painting and writing and any kind of art form, is seen as magic that only humans can wield, so you lose that when you become a fae. So yeah, I thought the whole concept was really interesting, and the whole book's really funny and compelling the whole way through. Incredible autumn woodland ambiance, and it's also always really fun to see like folklore accurate fairies as well. So that was a really good one. I'd say that one is probably a new favorite for me. Okay, so the next one I have on my list is Howl's Moving Castle by Diana Wynne Jones. So this story follows a hat maker, a girl who is a hat maker, and she is cursed with this aging spell. So she has to seek out the help of this wizard named Howl. So this wizard is very chaotic. He lives in this moving castle. And basically Sophie, the main character, she inadvertently becomes his like, kind of like his housekeeper slash live-in grandma. It's really funny, this whole dynamic, and it's just like delightfully fun and whimsical. I had to put this book down because I was laughing so hard. There's a certain part about halfway through that I just like, it's such a funny book. So yeah, it's kind of more of like a kid's story, but delightful. So such a good read. And I've been diving into more books by the same author and really, really have been enjoying them. So anyway, I also watched the movie and I didn't like the movie very much. I know it's a Ghibli film and I know it's kind of hallowed, but the book is just so much better to me personally. Anyway, Turn to Hallowed Place. Yes, it's very good. All right, we got some good ones coming up. Okay, so Uprooted by Naomi Novik. This book is also a new favorite of mine. It's just very brimming with mystery and magic, dark fairy tale vibes. Basically, it's about this malevolent wood, and it's this wood is continually starting to grow and overtake this valley, and the people of the valley rely on this powerful wizard known as the Dragon to keep the corrupted wood at bay. In return for his help, the dragon demands this terrible price, which is that once every 10 years, he will come to steal a girl away from the villages. So the main character is almost sure that when the dragon comes, he's going to choose her best friend, Kazia, but when the dragon comes, he chooses her instead. The biggest thing I remember about this story is that it was really addictive, and I think I devoured the entire thing in like a weekend. I really love Naomi Novik's writing as well. That's a new favorite, I think. Okay, so next up we have The Scorpio Races by Maggie Stiefvater, and this book is a masterpiece. I have read this book so many times, I've lost count. Like, the characters, the setting, the details, the world, everything about this book is perfect. So the story takes place on this remote island, and on this island, every single October, man-eating water horses emerge out of the ocean. So the people of the island capture them and train them, and every year on the 1st of November, they ride them in these very deadly races on the beach. Basically, picture like a cross between Misty of Shinkotigue and The Hunger Games. Ultimately, it's just this, it's a really atmospheric book, and it's really also defies explanation. Like, you really just have to read this to see what it's about. But yeah, that's going up there on the masterpiece list. Next up, we have The Name of the Wind and A Wise Man's Fear. So these are books 1 and 2 of the Kingkiller Chronicles, which is a series that's still ongoing. Just for reference, this book came out in 2007, and this book came out in 2011, and we are still waiting on book 3.
It's been 84 years.
But despite how long the series has been taking, these books are objectively some of the best fantasy of the last decade. It's the story of Kvothe, who's an orphan boy who ends up becoming one of the greatest magic wielders of all time. It's got kind of a little bit of everything. It's got coming of age, magic, mystery, little political intrigue, a little thriller, a little romance, even kind of a little bit of dark academia, because it is largely set at the school of magic. And also, as kind of an added bonus, the main character of the series is really fun to root for. And the world building is vast and sprawling, and it has one of the best magic systems I've ever read. So I think it's probably in the masterpiece category. It's honestly a really good series. All right, so now we're coming down to it. Okay, so the next book is Circe by Madeline Miller. So this is a vivid retelling of the Greek myth of Circe. I did so much annotating reading through this book. It's beautiful prose. prose, just the everything about this book was really masterfully done. So I would put that in the masterpiece category for sure. Okay, and to close things out, we're getting to one of my favorite fantasy writers that I've found this year, and that is Rebecca Ross. So the first series I read by her is Divine Rivals and Ruthless Vows. So this is her young adult fantasy. These books were delightful. So let me tell you a little bit about book one and why I love it so much. So it's the story of this aspiring journalist who writes letters to her brother who is on the front lines of the God's War. She writes these letters on this enchanted typewriter, but little does she know, these letters are not going to her brother at all. They're actually going to her rival at the newspaper. So basically it's You've Got Mail, but World War II fantasy edition. It's got a gloriously cozy fantasy world full of typewriters and trams and newspaper articles, rainy city vibes and trench coats, a little sprinkling of magic through the whole story that makes it really delightful. And see, these books are tricky because they start out as just kind of this cute enemies to lovers story. By the time book two rolls around, it grows into this profound reflection on selfless sacrificial love and the protection of all that is good. And the writing in these books is so lovely. I annotated and sticky noted the heck out of these books. I would definitely put these in, I think I'll put them here. But they're close to, I don't know, they're close to masterpiece status, but maybe not quite. And the next series is similar. I lent out the first book to my sister, so I just have the second book, but it's A River Enchanted and A Fire Endless, also a duology by Rebecca Ross. And these are, again, one of my favorite books of 2024 so far. Essentially, it takes place on this enchanted island, very Scottish inspired. And after 10 years studying to be a bard on the mainland, Jack Tamerlane is summoned home by his clan. When he arrives back at the island, he learns that young girls are going missing across the island. And if the Laird of the East is right about it being the spirit's fault, then Jack's music might be the only thing that can bring them back. So again, a very compelling, character-driven fantasy slash romance slash thriller. Probably one of the things I loved most about this series is just the incredible, lush ambiance of the world. So everything about the island, whether it's the cozy little crofts that they live in or the magical hills that change when you walk on them, it all feels so rich and lived in with detail. So yeah, those two have definitely earned a hallowed place upon my shelves as some of the best fantasy that I've read this year. So we finally made it. I think I have been filming this video for 5.5 hours because my camera keeps overheating. We finally made it to the end. Thank you guys so much for watching today's video. I would love to hear if you have read any of these books. Please share your thoughts in the comments below. I had a lot of fun putting this video together for you guys, and I really hope you enjoyed it. If you did, please give this video a thumbs up. That would mean a lot to me. And also feel free to subscribe to my channel if you're interested in more content that's about books and stories and the writing life. I've got a few video essays in the works that I'm really, really excited to share with you guys, a few of which I kind of hinted at throughout today's video. So if you're interested in watching any of those, just subscribe to my channel so you don't miss it. Anyway, thanks for hanging out with me and talking about books today, and I hope you guys have a wonderful day. Without any further ado, I will see you guys in the next video. Bye.